we may be done shooting for all I know. Please.
So my name is Jake, and the question I'm asking, so there's a new TV series, this is MacGyver, and I wanted to know if you've seen it or heard of it.
Oh, I've heard of it. I don't know if you all heard it, but he's asking about the new MacGyver show. Good response over there. Like, bleh. That was me. Good question. Serious question. Serious answer. I don't like it. Ego aside and all that, you know, well, why not me? That kind of stuff, that's over. Believe me. But in watching some of the episodes, it's not a MacGyver. It's not. It's just, I've become fond of describing it as a cop show with an iconic title. And because God, his partner's shooting everybody and killing everybody, and there's like, it just all happens way too fast, and it's like you're asked to believe, or you're asked to fill in a lot of the blanks, whereas what we did was we showed you those blanks, those steps along the way to solve the problem. They're just going right to, you know, he picks up a bunch of toothpicks or whatever, and all of a sudden he's got a hula skirt. That association, I have no idea. But you know what I mean, you don't see the process. And we prided ourselves on, this is why it was such not a pain, it was a joy, but it was really complicated to shoot MacGyver, because we have a new concept of a TV hero who didn't use a gun to solve that problem. You saw him see the problem, see him see elements of the solution, see him collecting it, putting it together, and then you see him, you know, weaving whatever toy he needed to solve that problem. You don't see any of that on the new MacGyver. Like I said, it's an, I guess, action-adventure cop show, in my view. And I don't wish them ill. Whatever success you can have, go for it. But I just don't like it. Hi, you.
Hello, sir. out of all 10 seasons of SG-1, what can you remember being your favorite Jock and Sam moment?
Makeout scenes. Paid to be on set, making out with a babe like her. She was married, right? those were always fun. And any scenes that I would have with, what's his name? Daniel. Yeah. Were terrific as well. Not for that reason. But he and I developed a really nice rapport, a nice banter rhythm, as with Amanda as well. But God, making out with her was just professional, mind you. So not professional. She kept having to say, "No tongue." I said, "No tongue." No, I was saying that to her. Well, why, you have another moment in mind?
I was just going to mention at the end of the episode, Window of Opportunity, when you hand in your resignation to kiss her.
What'd that do? resignation to her?
To General Hammond.
To Hammond.
So you could kiss her.
Oh! Cool moment. Yeah, that was, yeah. Now that I think back, that was a well-written moment, yeah, you're right. But as a totally lascivious human being, Megan, I was great. Yes, Kitty.
Did you learn how to juggle way before the episode, or did you learn just for the episode how to juggle?
I learned how to juggle by, well, like when I moved to California, I had a distant aunt or uncle or something like that that lived in Studio City, California. They had a backyard that had a shack, literally a shack, that they let me like sleep in, live in. And I shared it with a big old box turtle. It's about that big. It was great. I mean, we get along well. Didn't drink. He didn't drink. I don't know why. But what was I saying? Where was I? You live with a big turtle. Yeah, yeah. Somebody with a shack and orange trees in the backyard to live in. I got really healthy, eating all this vitamin C, but I also, you know, learned how to, just by figuring it out and watching. And I also had a buddy that moved to California a year prior, and he knew how to juggle and just gave me some pointers. The rest is, if I went on, you'd be bored to tears. But what happens was that when you're learning, you drop them a lot. So everything that I would drop eventually would split open. I'd have to eat it. Hence my good health. Thank you.
Hello, Richard.
Sorry.
Talking about going back to the concoctions, your MacGyver years, I was wondering, during that time, did they ever come to you and say, Richard, this is how you're going to save the day, this is what you're going to build, this is how you're going to do it, and you thought, yeah, that's never going to work.
Every week! My favorite example of the credibility factor was MacGyver's, some bad guy locks MacGyver into a jail cell out in the desert by an airport. Details. And so he locks me in there, and there's no way to get out. What's he going to do? What we had established on the way in, there were some things that you see that we'll come back to, obviously. One of them was a horse tied to the thing, and there was a bicycle, and a bucket of something else, and da da da. So the guy was got to get away and do stuff. So what he does, I'll fast forward, takes his belt and probably something else, item of clothing, makes a rope. Throws it and loops, somehow miraculously loops. See what I mean? Gets the bicycle and drags it close to him, and he starts breaking it down, breaking it apart. And there was a time when we did, I had to do all these voiceovers to explain everything. It was just so insulting, I thought, to the audience, because You can see what I'm doing, but there were some elements in retrospect that didn't need to be explained. This one, I swear to God, kept me laughing so long. I get the bicycle in and break it down, and the voiceover instructs the audience that if the bicycle is made of magnesium, and if another part of it's made from manganese, by this time I'm going, what? What are you talking about? No bicycle is not made of. Oh my God. Did anybody see that? Because I was dying. And I had to voice it over with a straight face. So anyway, the idea was to, if it's made out of manganese or whatever, then you could use one of the pipes on the frame and another part of the frame pipe and hit the manganese onto the magnesium, whatever, and create a spark, and out of it you would have a blowtorch. So I could cut through the bars of the gym. That's my favorite episode.
I wanted to ask you, what happens to MacGyver and his son at the end of season 7? Like, where did they go? What happened? What
yeah, they drive off into the sunset. on our motorcycles, we drove off somewhere, and we disappeared for about 35 years, and then apparently came back with a new series on CBS. And he's lost his temper too. We didn't answer that. We haven't really given much thought. You can fantasize whatever you want. That's part of the joy of an imagination. Thank you.
I wanted to ask, was the mullet your idea?
Yes. It happened somewhat accidentally. I don't know if I should share this. I had always had long hair. I mean, since the minute the Beatles came out and hit the States in 64, 5, 3, anyway, started coming over there, I started having long hair. It was a constant fight with my parents, well, my mom anyway. My dad was a man of humanities, and my mother was an artist, so I couldn't understand why she wanted me to have a skinhead, but that's what they preferred. So anyway, when I get into junior high school, when the Beatles came out, I let it go. Flash forward, still got long hair, I'm we're doing the early stages of MacGyver. And the weeks go by, we're doing more episodes. Guess what? Hair gets longer. It keeps going. But it started to get like this. Like, unmanageable. So I kept having to fix it. It wouldn't match on camera. So I'd keep doing this, and if it didn't match, we'd have to do it over again, and if it fell. Anyway, so the hairdresser cut the sides off so it wouldn't, I couldn't have to do that. But the back kept growing, and they didn't see fit to trim it up. Now you go so far with that, it becomes impossible to suddenly chop it off. Because things have to match, and there's a, you know, a sequence, an evolution to the character and his look and all that business. So it was kind of an accident, and then I just didn't fight anything anymore. Henry Winkler, here's why it was so blonde at times. Henry Winkler came to me, and I'm going to say the word S-H-I-T, is that okay? Henry Winkler came to me one point and said, Richard, would you mind if we put some highlights in your hair, and get some highlights in there, because your hair is so brown it looks like shit on a stick. For which I thanked him. But they put in some, the same guy that made the accident cutting, made the accident in bleaching, and it was, I swear to God, it looked like Billy Idol from Anyway, it's obvious that I care a lot about how my hair looks. But that's pretty much the evolution of that. And then, you know, there was Rod Stewart. There was the coach for the Kings at the time. Boy, if anybody knew it in this crowd.
Yeah.
And Barry Melrose, thank you. And then there was MacGyver. That was kind of the springboard for one of the worst designed haircuts ever. I mean, it worked during the 80s, but, you know, we shot into the 90s and beyond. If you see one today, anybody? Any mullets in the crowd? Anybody willing to admit?
Our time is like, we got 20 seconds left here. I'm sorry, we have another question, but
what? What's your question?
There, see? What a nice guy.
It's an old story, if you've heard it, stop me. But my father was a speech and English teacher and developed a humanities program at a high school in the Suburban Conference where I live, Roseville, Minnesota. Actually, he was in Columbia Heights. Anyway, he also directed school plays. So as a kid, I'd love to go with him for the rehearsals and you know, the after school rehearsals. And I'd sit in the audience chairs, really, in the seats, and watch this intriguing behavior on this stage with lights on and people using voices that sound, I mean, it was just a really odd spectacle that fascinated me for some reason. And during one particular scene, and I can't remember the play, but the part of the action was that a birthday cake gets served. Somebody comes out of the birthday cake and the scenes continue. Well, during the rehearsals, this one rehearsal anyway that I was observing, instead of having a cake, a prop cake or something, they brought out a tray full of Hostess Twinkies. Remember how old I am? And the seed was sown. I said, any job I could ever get that would allow me to eat free Twinkies is what I wanted to do.